Hi. So, it's a theme of the stories that have happened so far has been poverty, which I didn't really expect. And this story is actually going to be the complete opposite, because what I thought I would do is talk about my previous job as a corporate attorney in New York City. And, well, so the booing is apt because I wanted to talk about a sort of, you know, insider perspective, tell you some things about it that it'd be impossible for you to know unless you actually work there, to sort of, as it were, complicate what you sort of see in the news media. Really since 2007, we've been bombarded with this. I don't mean this as an apologia. I really just mean there was a guy before who talked about problematizing assumptions. So I mean something like that. It's just all lesbians of color on Wall Street, by the way. So I worked in New York City from 2007 to 2009 at what is probably, I think it's safe to say, it's in the top three of corporate law firms in New York City. And it's certainly the most prestigious banking law firm in the English-speaking world, hence the largest and oldest client of the firm is Goldman Sachs. The firm is over 125 years old. Its founding partners incorporated General Electric. They also negotiated what became the Panama Canal. Former chairmen include John Foster Dulles, who went on to become the director of the CIA and after whom Dulles International Airport in Washington, D.C. is named. What I wanted to talk about was the last deal that I worked on at the firm as an associate, which was the spin-off of Madison Square Garden Entertainment Complex. Most of you probably know this. It's a large building in New York City. Madison Square Garden Enterprises actually comprises a number of properties, including Radio City Music Hall. It's part of the same group, and also a number of sports franchises, including the New York Knicks and the New York Rangers. A spin-off is a particular kind of corporate reorganization, which just means a redesign or a reorganization of the corporate structure of a business, so the configuration of parent companies and subsidiary companies. All you really need to know about corporate reorganization is that when I say it, your eyes glaze over. This person right here looked and started talking to her boyfriend as soon as I said it. just notice what happens in your body when I say it, corporate reorganization, right? So like a curtain comes down in your mind and your attention goes into the back room, right? But so I invite you to think about what this means for any kind of scrutiny of any kind of financial transaction, even for people who are really interested in what's going on, like me and the other lawyers at the firm. Because corporate reorganization, that phrase, is the highest possible, most superficial description of what went on. So just imagine what kind of things would be going on between this woman and her boyfriend if I started describing to you in detail the spin-off. We might need a different curtain for that. So in order to do a spin-off, you have to produce a document, which is called an information statement, which describes the spin-off, and you send this to the board of directors of the company. In this case, Madison Square Garden is actually owned by a large broadcasting company, so you send it to the directors of the broadcasting company, and they look at it, and they decide whether to approve the spin-off, and then if they approve it, the information statement gets filed and publicly so that all the investors and potential stockholders can see what's happening with the company. So basically, it's a big brochure that describes what's going to happen, what the company is going to look like after the spinoff. And in our case, it was about 170 pages long. So in order to produce an information statement, you need one law firm and two investment banks. So we were the law firm. We had three lawyers on the deal. Myself as a junior associate with about 2 years of experience, my time was cost $250 an hour. We had a sixth-year associate, called a senior associate, whose time cost $400 an hour, and we had a senior partner who has decades of experience, and his time cost between $800 and $1,000 an hour. So we worked on this for about a month regularly. I billed probably $100 on the project, or 100 hours, sorry. The senior associate, let's say 75 hours. The partner, about 50, because there were a lot of conference calls. So the burn rate on a spinoff is about $95,000 a month just for the three attorneys. The investment banks always make more money than the attorneys. The reason is that they take on risk. We get paid no matter what. They only get paid if the deal happens. But if it happens, they make multiples what the attorneys make. So the burn rate on this deal is $95,000 a month just for the lawyers. So we work on it for about a month. And at the end of the month, we have this document. It's 170 pages long. And the day we need to send it out to the client, we're waiting just for two pieces of information, which is who's going to be the CEO of the reorganized company and who's going to be the COO, so the two most senior officers. So we show up to the office at 9 o'clock thinking they're going to send us the information, but they don't. At 10 o'clock, we have a car show up at the office. It's a town car, which is the standard mode of transportation for attorneys. It's a Lincoln town car with the leather interior, all that sort of thing. And the purpose of this car is to drive 25 copies of the document upstate to the client's headquarters so they can put it in the mailing to the board of directors. So they're going to talk about a lot of things at the board meeting, not just our spinoff. So you take the 170-page brochure, put it in an envelope with a lot of other documents, and send these to the 25 directors. So we need to get the document upstate by 3 p.m., which is the FedEx deadline for the client. So we have a car downstairs at 10 o'clock. They don't call by 10. They don't call by 11. At 12, they call. We've been doing this for a month. They just decide who's going to be CEO and COO. They call at 12. The car's been idling for 2 hours downstairs. It costs money for it to wait for us. So they give us the names. It appears in 6 different places in the document. So we put it in, and now we need 25 copies of a 170-page document, which is 4,250 pages. The firm actually has 2 photocopiers, in addition to all the other photocopiers that they have, which are really nice. They have 2 car-sized photocopiers that could do 70 pages a minute each. And I invite you to imagine what it looks like to see a page copied at less than 1 page per second. It's absolutely incredible. Maybe this is something that a lot of people, graphic designers here, I don't know, have experienced before. I've never seen anything like this. It's absolutely incredible. It takes something like 5 minutes with the copiers running in tandem to print off all the documents we need. And if we get them downstairs by 12:30, it'll be just enough time for the car to drive upstate with the documents. So halfway through the print off, they phone and change their mind. So the guy who was supposed to be the COO is now going to be the CEO, and vice versa. So we finish printing off the documents, take them up to a conference room. The CEO and COO information appears on 6 different pages in the document. So we make the change in 6 different places and then print off 25 copies of the 6 changed pages. I then commandeer 6 summer associates from a conference room. Summer associates are like interns, and they cost $150 an hour. So we go up to a conference room. There are 6 summer associates, myself, the junior associate, and the senior associate. We divide up the 175-page document, of which we have 25 copies, and we stand around the conference table swapping out the 6 pages to change the pages. The collective law school tuition of 8 people at a Wall Street law firm is well above $1 million US. So we're swapping out the pages. It's now 1:30. The car downstairs, the Lincoln Town car with the air conditioning and the plush leather interior for just boxes, has been idling for 3.5 hours, but 1:30 is not enough time for it to get upstate by 3 for the FedEx deadline. It's impossible with the traffic. So we phone up the client and we brainstorm for a bit, and they have a solution, which is that they're going to send the corporate helicopter to pick up the documents. Now, thankfully, our office happens to be right across the street from the Wall Street heliport, which is sort of the major heliport in New York. When the president comes to the UN, he comes into the Wall Street heliport and goes up to Midtown where the UN is. So it's close and convenient, but the problem is the street on which the heliport is opposite is actually the FDR, the Franklin Delano Roosevelt Expressway. It's the entrance, the on-ramp and the off-ramp. So it's 3 lanes each way with a large serious median in the middle, so you can't actually just walk across, even though it's only 50 yards. So what are we gonna do? We have, 25 copies of this 175-page document in these giant boxes. The car is still waiting for us. So we go downstairs and we get in this town car that's been waiting for us for now going on 4 hours. And he drives us for 35 seconds around the median, and we pull into the heliport. And we get out with the boxes and we walk into the heliport, and the helicopter arrives. It's a Sikorsky brand, which is a very fine corporate machine. And they open the back. There's nobody inside but the pilots. We put the boxes into the back. The carpet in a Sikorsky is actually so plush that the boxes sink when you put them in. Close the door, helicopter takes off, wave to the pilots, and we come back in. We get back into the car, which is still waiting for us, and we drive another sub-minute distance under the FDR, back to the office, sign for the car, and go back up to work. And that document has the highest carbon footprint of any document in the history of Wall Street. Thank you so much.